Hi everyone, this is Sonali. Thank you all for carving out some time for attending today's webinar on the episode 19th of the BusinessX learning series, Invest, Scale, Value and Exit. To all the attendees out there, please type in any questions you might have in the Q&A section and we'll try to answer as many as possible at the end of the session. I would now like to welcome our speaker, Mr. Gaurav Marya, Chairman and Founder of the Franchise India Group. A very warm welcome to you, sir.
Thank you, Sonali, and welcome, friends, and welcome to 19th edition. This is part of our BusinessX series. BusinessX is India's leading platform. It's actually a pioneer. We are pioneers in business resale and also helping the companies to raise capital. So this BusinessX was started by Franchise India Group about 6 years back, and we saw a great opportunity to really connect the startups, scale-ups to the investor community, and also a big work we saw in the case of a lot of business resale. We are the only company which has a full platform with 75 cities where we are active, where we are helping businesses which are now looking to exit. We value them and then put them to market. But today's discussion is all about scaling up, you know, and we do these four different parts every time. So we talk about investment, we talk about value creation, we talk about scaling, and we also talk about exit. These are the four pillars, so to say, where BusinessX really works on. So today we talk about the scaling up and how companies need to scale up a certain stage, what is the time when you need to really scale up, and also really the differentiation of a startup and a scale up. So that's something which we want to take up. Couple of things which needs to be clear: very few startups really see a journey of scaling up. Well, I think when you are a startup, in the first 3, 4, 5 years, you continue to bring the proof of concept, you get your commercials right, your business model right, you get your team in place, and so on and so forth. And only when you have a minimum viable product ready, and you also have a little bit of a what I call the scale-up infrastructure ready, and that's the only way you would probably start thinking on scaling up the business. So we are talking about today both the startups and scale-up, and I also would like to share that only 1 out of 200 startups would actually see a scale-up journey. And both are difficult. It looks like the startup is not difficult because you're absolutely new, you do not have a proof of concept, attracting the team and the talent is difficult. But I can tell you, scale-up is even more difficult. It's a very, very difficult strategy. It changes absolutely mindset, operational design, everything changes from when you are a startup. You are much more in comfort rather. And actually losing at that time can not be so problem. You know, if you have a bad quarter or bad 2 quarters or things of that nature, you can still gear up. But even when you want to scale up, there is a very little chance or very little option for you to do mistake. One mistake can cost you very, very heavily. I'll give you an example. Look at Zomato and Swiggy. Last year, 2019, they went too deep into this dark kitchen phenomena that they started investing themselves into dark kitchens. At Franchise India also, we helped Zomato to really get these kitchens all over India, which they made franchise models into. Similarly, Swiggy did about 150, 200 kitchens all over India. They ran about 8-9 months, and with this all this going on, they had to pack up the entire business. So all the investment which was done is all gone right. And I used to also question at that time, why are they doing it in the first place? This was not their business. They were aggregators. They were people who were building. A lot of people were really investing on them. This would have never been their direct investment. So a lot of these smaller mistakes companies do in the time of scale-up and which cost them dear. And that's where the real issues happen, the valuation error, and you are not able to attract the new set of investors coming in the business. So one has to be very clear about your strategy, where you are, and what you need to do there. And startup and scale-up are two different timings in your business journey. Startup is where you are just getting off the ground and you are settling on the business model, you're getting your proof of concept being done, your commercial success, early stage customers, getting your team in place, and so on and so forth. Startup has the biggest challenge is not really capital for me. I think the startup has the biggest challenge, and I've seen a lot of startup failing in, has been talent. Talent to attract for a startup becomes a huge amount of challenge, especially these days, because startup being by nature brings in a lot of uncertainty. And uncertainty people don't like at this stage. Good quality talent doesn't like uncertainty. So team strategy has to be changed. So unless and until you have something more, a founder has to have a story. Founder has to have a very strong conviction, and he's able to attract and the right kind of talent. That's the biggest problem I saw in startups. Startups, most of the startups, great idea, great innovation, great structure, but they don't have ability to attract the right kind of talent. Because the talent feels that the belongingness, the kind of belongingness required, the kind of time and investment required in this space is don't like. A lot of people also join because they feel that by joining the early foundation team can give them much bigger reward. But if you really ask me, it's not true. Truth is that the startups, a lot of startups fail. That's the reality of the business. So how do you really able to address and answer that? That's very important. And there really comes in the participation of the founders themselves. Unless and until they are able to really get that kind of confidence across, get them the right kind of, entire thing. And also a little bit of transparency as an organization. If you are well, bring that piece and get your first set of team in, then I think start up. But scale up, talent is much easier to get because you know much more in control of that. So let's understand that what makes a startup go to a scale-up strategy. Well, there are many mathematics in terms of your readiness for the market, your early user group or early customers, how they've used it, what kind of feedback is coming in, how is commercially your product or a service which you offered in that thing has been proven. But more importantly, have you seen 3-4 years of year-on-year growth, and that has to be also two-digit kind of a growth, 20-25-30% year-on-year growth for 3-4 years, then only you are ready for being called as a scale-up. Sometimes then also you are not ready. Well, because you might not have very stable customer base. You might have done financial growth, but you don't have very stable customer growth. And I'll give you some examples. Some companies become very confused. They try to do a lot of things just to get their financial growth going in. But really asking, if you go deeper into their books, you will find that they're doing a lot to do to get that number right. They're only chasing the number. There's no stability of their customer group is available there. Similarly, some companies are able to get the kind of, growth also, and they also have a stability of customer, but they don't have a scalable infrastructure. So that's also a big problem. You know, so sometimes you're really able to do everything right. Your customer is stable, your growth and financially has been proven last 2-3 years, 4 years, but you don't have an infrastructure. You cannot handle the scale story. Suddenly, if you move from, say, X position to a 10X or a 20X kind of a position, you are not ready. Your infrastructure is not ready. Your capabilities are not ready. Your team structure is not ready. So that also has to be seen. So there are pretty much three things. Stable customer group, financial performance for last 3 years for at least 20-25%, 30% growth, and also scalable infrastructure along with that. If you get these three things done, then you probably would be ready for any kind of a scale-up. For a startup, I feel that there are a lot of startups which perform in the first 3-5 years, and I call them the gap between nice-to-have products and must-have products. That's something which is a very big problem. You know, I feel that there are a lot of startups which have products which are what I call nice-to-have. If they have, this is a good, compelling product, but it's not must-to-have, which means it is not a necessity bill. It's not a replacement. It's not replacing something, right? And I feel that this must-have products, to me, are much more useful to go to the next level of scale-up story. Nice-to-have would just survive, and then normally either are bought by somebody who finds strategic value in the innovation which is done or some kind of a structure, and they will not be able to scale their own thing. But these must-have have a big opportunity to really go on that. So a lot of startups are actually about 95% are in nice-to-have kind of a placement. So they need probably at a certain stage look at some kind of integration, M&A opportunity or something like that. But these companies are certainly ready for the huge scale-up opportunity in that. Now we talk about a lot of constraints in both setup businesses, startups, and we'll also talk about the scale-up. And in the meantime, if you have questions, keep writing on the questions on the Q&A box, and I will take up those questions as we go closer to the next 15 minutes. So one of the areas which I found in startup, the constraint, as I said, one constraint was clearly the team. Team was a big constraint. And I feel that one of the biggest challenges in startups is getting the right talent on board. And that's something which is very difficult. Because at that stage, even if you offer equity or you offer some kind of sweat equity or something like that, that's also not attractive because the business has built no value, so to say, or it has a very long distance before it can logically give unlock value for somebody to do that. So even if you give somebody, say, look, I would like to offer equity in my startup, you are not able to attract that. You used to. 3, 4, 5 years back, this was working very well. But now these days, if a startup comes to you and say, I want to really hire you and I want to give you small equity, a lot of people are not buying it because a lot of, so to say, bad stories, especially in this period, and last 2 odd years, I've seen a lot of dropouts, a lot of companies falling out, and it has really impacted the talent, and there is a nervousness in the talent of not joining startups because they feel that there is a stability. But the second big challenge I see in startups is a marketing. While it looks like a simple term, but somehow startups are too passionate about making their product, service, and so on. So while this is all right, but they don't do too much of what I call go-to-market marketing. It's very, very important. I think most of the startups, and now we have a lot of these companies like Times of India, which is BCCL, Hindustan Times, a lot of other companies also heavily supporting through their marketing equity to these startups because they feel that the missing link in startup to really get the early customer base and get your window up and so on and so forth is a marketing. So marketing becomes a very important because the early traction you need to gain is through going to come through a marketing, and sometimes you just feel that just by organically you will be able to build that business model, and their financial model normally don't have they have not captured a marketing budgets. The cost of acquisition of a customer in a lot of startups I've really survived is not there. And while the good startups would have a very strong cost of acquisition, and the cost of acquisition to me is a very important portion when you are driving your startup business model, it needs to have that impact. But now let's go to pretty much I would say in the startup, I would see these two are really the challenge. And the third is obviously if you don't have a what I call minimum viable product, which needs to come in. But apart from that, talent and marketing would play the most important aspect of it. But when you're a scale up, then there is a multiple challenges coming in. Multiple challenges. Let's start with a couple of them. One is the team shift. I feel that the biggest challenge I saw is that when the same startup team, which came down to scale, they were not able to handle it. And because you need a different kind of mindset, you need mature players, they need to understand multiple markets, and they need to be a strong process leaders. You know, when you're a startup, you're pretty much doing multitasking. You don't lead processes. You're all over because you need to have a bootstrap, and you have to have one person doing multiple tasks and so on and so forth. And when you become a scale up, you need process champions. You need process champions. So there need to be a lot of maturity in your team. So there is a huge shift, and this shift is very difficult now because you are coming from a startup and you have these people who stood by you, built this business, came down to a certain level. Now the business is trading at, say, 60, 70 crores, but you are now looking at 60, 70 crores to go to 1,000 crore. It needs a different mindset. And that call at that stage to take, there is a lot of emotional issues which are concerning because you want to take the same guy, a guy who is handling your a 30 crore balance sheet is not the same guy who can handle your 1,000 crore balance sheet, right? So even your CFO, you like it or don't like it, has to change. So a lot of changes has to come in, and these are sometimes pushed upon by the investor. And sometimes a founder has to really take those calls because founder has to surround himself with the next orbit team or the next structure. So one of the big shift really happens from a startup to scale up is a team shift. Which is sometimes not very smooth, and that can create a lot of issues because if it is not smooth, it is not designedly done, then you get into a problem. Second big thing is culture. This is very personalized, very involved, very intimate kind of a culture at a very well startup. When you go to a scale, you become more process, review driven, data driven, and so on and so forth. So there is lesser emotional but more data running in the entire thing. But this is very emotional. Everything is very connected. People to people relationship really works. So culture has to shift and change. While all people say that the culture remains same, answer is absolutely no. I have met with so many people who were part of the founding teams, and now they're part of a very large company, scale company, and they're moving out. And the one thing I ask them, why are you moving out now when the company has really become excited? They would say, it's not the same culture, I don't enjoy anymore. But the truth is, the business itself has changed. You know, so if you're running a large corporation, people who would have joined the Ola and Uber in the initial days, and they used to do the business at a very different level. They can pick up phone and call founder anytime and have a discussion. They had these a lot of small team meetings. Every win is being celebrated. And to a company which is now a large company, everything has to change. So the culture has to be designed again. Rather than people get shocked, you need to really move this into a very conscious approach of how you change the culture. Financial management and cost efficiencies. This is another big problem happening in the scale time. Scale time is a little bit of crazy style. So it's, everything is, looks like going out of control. Everything is going out of control. You know, and I've seen companies like Ola, and once I was there in the office, and I found people are doing meetings at odd hours and 1:30 in the night and things of that nature, and they're just spending money and all over wherever they can, and they're just going all over without sometimes putting a lot of thought process. And sometimes this is done by people who have very little management bandwidth. I've seen people who have 3, 4, 5 years experience and taking decisions which can cost huge to the company. And these are because of the rush of just growth. You know, they have a very unrealistic quarter-to-quarter targets, so they actually don't do very strong financial and cost efficiencies, and that goes out of control. Market penetration, that's also very important. You need to really see that which markets you want to go as scale up. You don't have to go all over. Like OO Rooms went into 80 countries. Now, some countries have been phenomenal for them. China has been phenomenal. Some countries are being saver in these times because India is not there. But I feel that a lot of countries, they just went and they have no penetration. They just are floating. And you see post next 2 to 3 months, there would be a huge correction which would come in, and they would then have to stick to few markets only. And that happens when you don't think through and go to these just expansion of going to multiple markets. One has to really think through which markets you need to go and penetrate well. Founders capability also is another challenge. I find that a lot of founders are not able to adapt the change, or they are ready for the next orbit. And because they are founders, everything revolves around them. And if they don't have ability to detach themselves and really start seeing business from a different viewpoint, that also becomes a big problem. A shift from innovation to execution. Founders love innovation. They just are focused on creating new ideas and working on this and so on and so forth. So they're too deep on that. So they typically would spend 60-70% time by choice on that. And now you're in a different business. You're more spending time with your CFOs. You're spending more time on board meetings. You're spending more time on your financial execution and a lot of other things. And these start taking a lot of time. So founders, while they have to still do innovation, but they have to shift the focus from innovation to execution. Execution takes, a lot of founders don't like execution, really speaking. They're pretty innovation minded. They're always creators. And they start hating these situations. They need to come to in terms with that. They need to come to terms that they would really spend in most times in board meetings or reviews and things of that nature rather than just on a product side. Some have beautifully done that. I mean, we all talk about Steve Jobs. He was a great marriage between innovation and execution, right? And very few people have that kind of ability. But if you see that anybody who's following that, they're not so much in innovation. They're more in execution, making sure that the balance sheet of the company continues to do that. And that's also Steve Jobs also had some major financial problems in his life because sometimes he was too innovation driven and he never thought to really sustain the business. And sustainability became a problem in terms of a couple of times the company went into almost becoming a bankrupt. But if you look at Apple now, it's all about super efficient execution, seamless execution. That's the company. Today, I will not rate Apple as a very big innovator. It's a very strong execution company, something very similar to Microsoft or things of that nature. So they know how to bring in brilliant distribution, timing, everything else, whatever they do, a lot of work they do to make sure that the company is performance driven. So that's a very important part of the shift. Technology is another thing which should move from startup to a scale up. Technology is by nature cannot be avoided, but when scaling up, you need a lot of technology. Everything has to go on technology. This is something which I think is a super tick mark. If you don't get that tick mark done, don't venture it out, because you cannot manage that kind of scale without having everything coming on data. And unless and until you have everything on data and you can read, you know your customers, why they're buying, what they're purchasing, everything has to come through this. If you're not ready, postpone your scale idea for some time. First, get your technology in place. Last mile quality assurance. Another thing which has happened in a lot of scale up that they lose control over their product on quality. And that's something which goes on and on. And you suddenly realize that the customer has shifted and all gone. And that happens with a lot of companies, I think, which are especially with the consumers front companies. And they were not able to really have and retain their customer base because they were losing focus on the quality part of it. Just by the scale, they were losing focus. And scale is the rapid expansion, that's for sure. Like, look at the companies, you know, these companies, the delivery companies, are very, very sophisticated companies. If you really look at them, they efficiently manage only one thing. The trust of customer is still there, that Zomato or Swiggy would deliver you on time and every time. Ola and Uber would make sure that they pick you up from the last mile. And that's why these scale-ups, all these large companies, became so successful because they never lost an eye on the last mile quality. And a lot of other companies which are very similar to them packed up because they were not able to do it. A lot of dropouts would happen, customer complaints would happen, escalations would happen, and all these pieces would actually disturb. So founders actually put a lot of focus. I remember these early days when Flipkart was done, there were some of the collections, some of the deliveries, Bansals used to do themselves. They used to go to houses and deliver products, and it was actually a great way of PR, but more importantly, I think it was also to see the connect, see the whole flow, see how it works, and so on. So, because end of the day, it was all seamlessly, and they had this window. They had this window because Amazon was not there, and at that time, they need to really set their roots right and scale the business to a certain level. That when the big boys come in, which are super efficient, super technology, they are able to maintain that. Then key suppliers have to be done. Another problem I've seen in scale ups is that they try to do a lot of things themselves. They would keep opening up new departments in their business, and that would become a huge cost side for them. And more importantly, it takes a lot of energy, drain the energy of the company. So you need to really see anything which is non-core to you. Even say hiring of your people, training of your people, anything which is non-core. Maybe if the critical processes are there, you have to train in-house. But rest, everything has to be outsourced. You need to have a very strong vendor base. This is what I like about these American companies. Like you work with McDonald's or places like that. Before they even open up, they would take at least 1 year to set their back-end supplier capabilities. They really work and actually invest on the suppliers and build their capabilities to be ready to support them. And they focus themselves on the core value, and that's where the energy goes in. Otherwise, you start doing it. Like, look at the biggest chain in the world, McDonald's. They don't have central kitchen up there. Not even a single. And you see small outlets, I see restaurant players, first thing you do, they put a big central kitchen. Now, I say, why you put central kitchen? Because they would say, we want to show the quality. But McDonald's doesn't have it. McDonald's has good suppliers. They have put basic facilities. There is Vista Food, there is Cremica Food, there is a lot of other companies available. They have put great capabilities to service McDonald's. At a stage also, when McDonald's was just a very small company in India, say very few stores, these companies were really building capabilities. And that's how they were grown. So you don't have to really start doing everything else. And this eats up all good capital from you. And second, it doesn't give you any entitlement. So you need to really focus on how you want to build your key suppliers. Productivity is another big issue. And especially now, almost all scale-up companies are facing a big problem in productivity. You know, these people are movement, they're not effective, they're not entitled. How do you really monitor productivity? And that's very important. And finally, forecasting next round capital raise. Your timing is very important. 6 months before you even know that you need money, at this kind of money, you need to start working 6 months in advance. So that cycle has to go. Rather, I would say a separate team just keeps focusing and keep the eye that you never have a problem where you're running on an empty tank. That's a dangerous thing. Even if you have a 1 quarter window of any scale up, not having adequate gas available, wood can go absolutely drain out, because this can be a very, very dangerous situation. And we've seen a lot of good companies, but at a certain stage, they were not able to raise and they were not able to survive. And that's happened with a lot of companies. And I can tell you, some of the companies also are struggling today. Look at, and they got confused, right? Like the company I always give example, which is very confused at this stage, is like OLX. Started for something, became something, now doing something. So it's just lost the plot itself. They don't know what they need to do. So these are some of the concerns and structures which happens in any of a startup company. But there is a difference between scale thinking and startup thinking, and that something which has to one has to very clearly understand, and then only you will do that. I also did a episode on growth and scale. Growth was actually about that when you do growth, which means the growth by little means that you're taking something becoming more bigger or larger, which means that when you do a growth, you would have to deploy maybe equal amount of proportionate resources on that. So it means add more people, more offices and things. But when you do scale, you actually don't deploy in the same proportion. With a very little resources deployed, you can multiply much faster. That's a scale strategy, and that's what technology companies are good at and a lot of other companies. So you need to really have a couple of things in mind when you're doing scale up. You need to have a very strong planning. You need to focus on key issues, key core value. Don't change the core. You need to take a good leadership team. You need to hire and fire on time. I can tell you one fund which we're working with, on the 25th, I think, on March, they called all the investing companies, you know, and about 25 of them in market. And the first thing they said is go and cut the teams. And this was very difficult because all the companies were adequately funded. They were sitting on money. And they said, just from that, they very clearly saw. And I can tell you that a lot of other funds were not able to do it. A lot of investors actually shied away from taking tough decisions. So you need to, when you're riding somebody's money, riding a lot of these funds and the pension funds and things of that are all riding on you. So sometimes we get too serious about this because we're taking a decision on somebody's salaries and things of that nature. But you also should to understand that this money which is invested in your company is also investment, hard-earned money of somebody. So in perspective, while you try to say that, look, I'm trying to save my team here, but you are also then doing a damage to somebody's capital who's been invested. And if the capital is invested by, say, pension funds, these people have retired, they work very hard, and now they've invested into these funds, and these funds are then invested into companies. If the companies don't really do well, so you can imagine what kind of damage they are doing to these potential investors, which have no clue how you're managing and running a business, right? So this is also very important. Sometimes hard decisions are taken to save somebody else. It's a very important part. So you need to really know when to hire, when to fire. You need to also not postpone your next round. Anytime you give an opportunity to raise, raise. Because there is always a time to raise. And that's very important to need to be done. And you need to have built agile teams. These agile teams are always in the market, understanding what market is telling them. And they're quickly able to adopt their pieces. Another area which is very important, that 70%, 75% odd failures happen because of what I call premature scaling. Because you're not ready and you just start scaling up, and then you would have a big problem in that. So you need to have the right team in place. Your customers have to be there and they should be stable, and there has to be predictability and stable revenues and profit forecast. Your margins have to continue to improve over the time, and you are able to control your cost structure. If you are able to all do this, then you are ready for your scale-up story. So this is today's episode. We do have half an hour normally, and it's already 30 minutes, so I can quickly take some of the questions which are available with the Sonali. If you have some questions for me, I can happy to take a few questions for 2-3 minutes. So.
Sure, sir. Thank you so much for another wonderful session, Gaurav, sir. We do have quite a few questions lined up with us. And the first question I would like to take up is from Mr. Shantanu Saha. He says, do you think staff functions can be outsourced by startups to help them scale up as they can focus purely on business delivery?
Yeah, some of the functions you can and you should outsource. And that's what I've been saying, that outsourcing is very important rather than building strong relationship with these outsourcing firms. And some of the firms you should really, when you're looking at scale up, they are your key vendors, your OEMs. So you need to really make sure that you work with them also and their teams also, that their capability is also growing. But you should not participate in their companies. You know, let them run as an independent company. I've seen mistakes people have done. They've gone and invested back in their supplier companies and things like that. And that's all wrong. They are anyway taken care by the business they get from you. So, but you need to really choose the right companies. You need to also choose who can service you in all markets. But you should outsource some of them, I think. And that functions, staff function, one has to understand which functions you can outsource, which you cannot, like in hospitality, all the banqueting and other staffing and everything, they all outsource. and they would core services which are their own restaurants and you know, the back of the house, a lot of senior management. This is all available with the hotel, but all the other staff is on other party's role. So that's how it works.
Right. The next question is from Mr. Sandeep Budhrani. He says, how do you know you've reached a scale-up stage? Is it by way of how much your turnover is to a particular amount? If so, what is the amount?
Good question. What is the stage where you are scale-up? So scale-up is multiple qualifying tick marks has to be done. Apart from your product being viable now, second, your team infrastructure being plain and scale infrastructure and team is in place. Third, your last 3 years performance clearly shows financial and your customer retention is clearly telling you that there is impacting. And fourth, enough opportunity and timing available for the next 2 years. So if you are scaling up, then next 2 years should be very clearly predictable that this is a best time to really do that. Like these days, maybe the opportunity is there, but sometimes timing is not the right because cash flows and liquidity and all of other issues are in the market. But there are great opportunities sometimes, which I think can be doing 2021 great. But so one has to really see timing and what is an opportunity forecast for next 2 years.
Right. The next question is from Mr. Anil. He says, is the services industry scalable? More specifically, bespoke tailoring, which is very skill intensive at every stage of the process.
Yeah, so I mean, this is right. So one has to really do how you really want to engineer. I personally feel that technology has done a lot in bespoke and made to tailor. So kind of because the technology has given you that opportunity now, a lot of things can be done and come closer to that. But yes, it has to strong process being in place. But there is an opportunity. And also, you need to know the end game. You know, scale can have different meaning, right? It's scale by nature means you're measuring it to something, right? So for bespoke, you're measuring it to something different. You know, if I was a value fashion, then I'm measuring it to something else. So scale for bespoke can be, say, 75 locations. Right, and that is a big scale, but for a value clothing it might be 750 locations, right? So it depends on what you want to measure to and how you want to do that. But yes, I think services industry there is a lot of good scale up ideas. I mean, all these examples I've given you are actually service providers, you know, Zomato and Ola's and Uber's and everything is actually a service provider, and actually you solve a big problem. And bespoke itself is a big problem because fundamentally everybody wants the best clothes to their fitment. So if you are able to address this problem, there is a answer to it. And technology can support today. And I think technology is giving you that opportunity today in this sector. A lot has happened in this sector, especially in China, Hong Kong. Also, I've seen some companies in Europe are doing very well. Some of the big boys are doing it because they have the bespoke capabilities available everywhere in the market.
So the next question is from Mr. Vivekanand Gopal. He says, how important is it to have systems and processes in a startup?
Very important. More than startup, I think scale-ups need to do all in systems and processes. Startup, by nature, should not be too much system and process-oriented. While they need to follow it, because we need to also have a lot of flexibility to change, because we are in a adaptation phase, you know, while things are have to change probably on a much frequently. But as you got to a scale story, then the processes have become very definite and you need to have a regime to follow systems and processes. So I think but foundation of that has to be put when you are a startup.
Right. And following up on Mr. Vivekanand's question, he also says, sir, do you have any program that helps startups to scale up?
Yeah, so we essentially have a consulting arm which works on, which we call, Entrepreneur India, which works with different entrepreneurs, especially at the startup stage, to build a strong 3 to 4, 5 year, growth story and the capability development so that they can be ready for a scale up. And so we do that, but in many few industries, we are not good at all industries, I'll be honest. And few industries, like especially services-based industries, especially franchising businesses, we are very strong on that. But franchising, obviously, we're market leaders, so we like franchise businesses. Franchise also is a great scale story because you can really grow your business and brand to multiple markets without putting your own team and capability.
Right. So now, sir, I would just like to take up the last question for the day. The question is how to retain employees while scaling up, because that's a real struggle.
It's a retain employees? Sorry, in the scale up?
While scaling up, yes.
So retention, I've told you that this is one of the biggest problem in both the situation is retention. And when you are a startup, there is a different set of problem in manpower and retention. One, getting the right talent is a big problem. And second, retaining the talent because of the kind of expectation of the talent and is not sometimes matched. So a lot of emotional values have to play a very important role. A lot of bonding, one-on-one discussion, a lot of transparent way of approaching the whole thing. A lot of belief systems work very well. A lot of softer side of things work very well. In the scale-up, it's all about growth. Challenging and giving high growth. People like, professionals like that. They like to give their few years where they were part of something which is becoming very, very big. They like it. So you need to give them chance. Empowerment would play a very important role in the retention of people. I think in scale-up, people leave because they get frustrated by not able to do what they want to do, or their ideas not heard, or they're not being empowered enough, or things of that nature. That frustrates you to really do that. And especially if they've come along the journey from a startup to scale-up, they are overwhelmed by things going out of their control and a lot of other people taking more responsibility and they are not able to do it. So they feel a little choked at that stage. So, and that's where you need to really give them more empowerment, give them more capability, and then they would go out and do that. People enjoy the scale-up. Startup is always tough. Startup is very tough because you're struggling on things and you're always insecure the next month paycheck would come, not come. But in scale-up, that piece is gone. Now you know the company is on the right way of big growth. The only thing which can choke them is their ability to really contribute.
Absolutely, sir. So lastly, I would just like to request you to input your contact details here, because there are a few requests from people who would like to get in touch with you and share their business plans and ideas with you.
Sure. Anybody can reach me, and this is my email ID, gm@gauravmaria.com. Please reach me, and I'll be more than happy to take up any questions you have or any suggestions which you need from us, visit businessx.com, franchisenet.com for further news, and I think on entrepreneur.com. Entrepreneur is our news piece. On Franchise India is an opportunity piece, and BusinessX is a resale and investment platform. Thank you very much. Thanks, Sonali, for hosting another one. It's a 19th, and next week we will see you on a 20th edition of BusinessX Scale, Invest, Exit, and Value.
Thank you so much, Gaurav sir. Thank you for sharing your valuable insights with us and for a wonderful session as always. We look forward to having you with us next week as well.
Thank you very much. Thank you.